Welcome to tonight's program. My name is Gary Privo. I'm the director of the Global Awareness Lecture Series. And tonight we have the opportunity to re-engage a topic that captivated the world just 18 months ago in what we have come to call the Arab Spring. Those events that occurred across the Middle East, beginning in Tunisia and then to Egypt and to many other countries in the region, when long-standing governments were challenged from below by their citizens, demanding more say in their lives, and ultimately produced across the region some new rulers and changes. No more important in that piece was in many ways the country at the heart of that region, Egypt. And that's going to be the focus of our program tonight, though I'm sure our visitor will entertain broader questions about the region, but his focus is going to be Egypt. We're privileged tonight to have with us Professor Ragui Assaad, who is professor of public affairs at the Humphrey Institute at the University of Minnesota. He holds a PhD in city and regional planning from Cornell University and a master's degree in mechanical engineering from Stanford University. He is a non-resident senior fellow at the Global Economic and Development Program of the Brookings Institution in Washington and a research fellow of the Economic Research Forum of Egypt. He served as the regional director for West Asia and North Africa for the Population Council based in Cairo from 2005 to 2008. His current academic research focuses on labor markets in the Arab world with a focus on youth and gender issues as they relate to education, transition from school to work, employment, migration, and family formation. Tonight, he will be speaking to you as a kind of generalist audience under the topic Making Sense of Developments in Post-Revolution Egypt. He's going to speak for about 45 minutes, and following that, we hope for a very engaging half an hour or so of questions and to try to bring the program to a conclusion before 9 o'clock. We're respectful of your time this evening, but hope that you can learn much from him and be ready to engage him during the question and answer period. So, Professor Ragui Assaad.
Thank you very much, Gary. Over the years, I've had a number of students from St. John's and St. Ben's as my students at the Humphrey School, and they're usually very good students. So I hope I can convince some of you to consider coming to the Humphrey School after today. I was on sabbatical last year and spent the whole year in Egypt, and so in a sense had a front seat view of what was going on during this very eventful year. And as we were kind of going through these events, it was always fasten your seatbelts. There is turbulence ahead. There was something happening just about every day, and we were trying to make sense of it. And as I get a little bit more distance from it, I'm starting to understand it a little bit better, get out from the trees and look at the forest. But I have to admit that I sometimes have a tendency to get mired in the trees, so I hope I don't do too much of that today. So essentially, we have the events of the Arab Spring have led to a great deal of concern on the part of many in the West that the Islamists are taking over, that the Muslim Brotherhood, which is many people kind of associate with all kinds of radical Islamist groups, mistakenly so, I think, is kind of taking Egypt to a new form of theocracy or a form of a new form of authoritarianism based on religion. So I wanted to look at basically, was the victory of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt inevitable? Is it irreversible, as some people claim it is, as they take over and write the new rules? Are we moving to a civil democratic state or a new form of authoritarianism? And try to understand a little bit the role that the military has played in the transition over the past 18 months, because it was a very critical role and one that is somewhat difficult to understand, even for people who were very close and watching day-to-day events. Now, of course, the transition in Egypt has a number of international and regional implications, and I'll probably leave some of those to the question-answer session. So while my focus today is going to be mostly on Egypt, I will be more than happy to entertain questions about the region as a whole and the dynamics of the Arab Spring elsewhere. So you're either, by looking at what happened in this part of the world, you're either very confused, which many people are, or sometimes people see it in a very clear-cut way. And a lot of politicians basically say this is, the Arab Spring has morphed into an Islamist winter. Essentially, the takeover by Islamist group has basically, they've hijacked the Arab Spring. And the Muslim Brotherhood, which I'll refer to as MB from now on, appears to dominate politics. They won every single election that has taken place in Egypt since the fall of the Mubarak regime. They won their confrontation with the military most recently when they ousted the top generals and basically took the president of Egypt, who's a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, took over from the military council that had dominated the country's politics. And they are actually currently dominating the constitution writing process through the Constituent Assembly. So looked at from, it seems very clear-cut, but I'm going to argue today that in fact from the inside it's a much more nuanced view and much more complicated view that, and while I may not give you too many answers, at least I will complicate the simple picture that looks like the Islamists have have a wholesale takeover. So I'm going to argue basically that the political scene is still very fluid. There are a lot of different actors that are vying for power in this political scene. The groups that organized the revolution, the young people, the so-called April 6th movement, and the other youth groups that were very active in opening up this political space, in fact, took the lead in the revolution, have not yet managed to organize themselves into an effective political force, but the stress is on the word yet, because they have not given up, and they have not just gone home. They are still very much in the political arena, learning how to play politics and how to organize themselves. And so there is a tremendous hope, and these groups are anything but Islamic. They may have an Islamic wing to them, or an Islamist wing that is sympathetic to the Muslim Brotherhood, but there is the vast majority of them are more secular, liberal in their orientation. There's also the rise of a fairly new force in Egyptian politics, which is also Islamist, but of a very different kind from the Muslim Brotherhood, and this is the Salafis. The Salafis are ultra-conservative groups that had not been political in the past, that have basically focused primarily on getting people to behave in more religious ways, outwardly so, as well as, and they tend to be much more decentralized than the Muslim Brotherhood. They're not organized under a single organizational framework like the Muslim Brotherhood, but they also tend to often disagree with the Muslim Brotherhood, although they could ally themselves with them for tactical reasons. And in fact, even the external allies of the Muslim Brotherhood and the Salafis are different. The Muslim Brotherhood finds its strongest external alliance with Qatar, which is this small, rich emirate in the Gulf. In fact, and they don't get along very much with the Saudis. The Saudi Arabia is not a major supporter. In fact, it's somewhat antagonistic to the Muslim Brotherhood, whereas the Salafis get a lot of their support from the Saudis, and they made their presence on the ground through large charitable contribution coming from Saudi Arabia that are then distributed to poor communities in Egypt. So these provide some uncertainty in the way the sorts of alliances that can be created. Now, so essentially we have a highly politicized and engaged population after the revolution. If you talk to any taxi driver in Cairo at any point, they will be very enthusiastic to tell you what they think about politics. So whereas before the revolution, people were somewhat apathetic, they were dissociated from politics. So right now we have an engaged population that is simply not going to allow yet another sort of dictatorship to take over. And I think that's what gives this the scene its fluidity. So let me kind of tell a story by using this timeline of events in the revolution as a backdrop. And in particular, I want to kind of stress the mechanics of the transition as conceived initially by the elites, but particularly by the military council that took over after Mubarak left office on February 11th, 2011. That military council essentially was said, we'll take care of the country's transition and we will shepherd along the country towards democracy. But so you young people go home and we'll take care of things from now on. That essentially was the message that was given. And the young people, after 18 days of struggle, were willing to let the military kind of try its hand at the transition. So the first thing that the military council did is they organized a referendum on March 19th to determine certain changes in the old constitution that had been, the original constitution had been passed in 1971. They had a referendum for changes in a few articles of this constitution, but based on that, came up with what is called a constitutional declaration, which was going to be the temporary constitution of the country through the transition until a new constitution is agreed upon. Now, the most important thing in that constitution, there's a lot of aspects to it, but the most important thing is that it gave a certain, there was a certain sequence to the transition. So the sequence was that they had suggested that there would be first parliamentary elections. Then the parliament would select a constituent assembly of 100 members, and that constituent assembly would write the constitution, and after the constitution is written, there would be a presidential election. So this is how originally the transition was conceived, and now watch the rest of the story, but because this transition sequence was completely turned on its head in actual fact. But the problem with that is that immediately a split emerged between the Islamist forces, who were very much in favor of this sequence, because they knew they were very organized, they had a lot of presence on the ground, and they could win a parliamentary election very easily. Whereas the liberal and secularist forces and the youth groups knew that they weren't organized and they needed time to basically be able to compete effectively in a parliamentary election. So they wanted first the constitution first. So their kind of motto was constitution first, followed by parliamentary and presidential elections, and that sequence was not. In fact, in the referendum, ended up 77% of the people voted in favor of the referendum, in favor of the constitutional changes and that sort of sequence, that the one that the military was suggesting. But there were all kinds of scare tactics. In fact, people were told, if you don't vote yes for the referendum, you're voting against religion. You're voting against, and so this is where the sort of tactics of using religion as a way of scaring people away from voting the other way. But essentially you had those who wanted return to peace and security so that they can get their lives back, and those who wanted the Islamist politics to have an advantage basically had a coalition against the more liberal forces. Okay. Now, May and July, from May through the summer, you had people getting frustrated with the way the military council was running the country, which was pretty heavy-handed. They were throwing protesters in jail. They were trying civilians through military courts. You have all these scenes of protesters being mistreated. And so the protests kept increasing over that period, to the point where in the fall, October and November, you had a couple of major events that created basically very large street protests. In fact, the first one was in October 2011, where there was an attack on a Christian church that was burned down in the south of Egypt. And these attacks had happened. There were several that happened since the revolution, and there would be some small protest about it, but it would die down. But in this case, the Christian protesters were marching towards the TV building to basically show their anger at what happened to the church. And the military claimed that they shot at the guards of the TV building and reacted very violently, killing 25 protesters. So, and some of them were actually, they rolled over them with these military vehicles. So that was a very traumatic moment, but it had affected a minority Christians, so yet the majority was not engaged. But then followed in November with another protest. In this case, it was the Islamists groups protesting against the military because the military wanted to get through something called supra-constitutional principles. They didn't trust the people who were going to write the constitution, so they decided that we're going to at least have some supra-constitutional principles that we would agree upon before we elect the constituent assembly. And it just happens that among those supra-constitutional principles was one in which the military has full autonomy over its budget, the military has full autonomy over appointments of its commanders, and civilians basically don't have much say in terms of what the military does. So they were trying to protect themselves from whatever civilian government comes after that. And of course, this resulted in some huge protests with 40 deaths, and forcing the civilian government that the military had appointed to resign. Another government was appointed by the military, again, over severe protests. Nobody liked the choice that the military made. It was the prime minister was a former prime minister from the Mubarak regime who was in his late 70s and not at all reflecting the youthful nature of the revolution. But at least when they appointed this government, said, look, the transition that was supposed to take approximately 2.5 years, they said, we're going to leave power by June 30th. Now that immediately scrunches down the timetable because leaving power by June 30th means that the president, civilian president, had to be elected by June 30th and taking power by then. Then starts very soon after these protests, the parliamentary elections. The parliamentary elections were very complicated. I'm going to start telling you some of the complications, but not all, because first of all, there are two houses of parliament. There's the lower house and the upper house. The upper house is a relatively novel addition and not as important as the lower house. The lower house is like the House of Representatives in this country. But the lower house of parliament had to be elected according to two different electoral modes. You have party lists where people are elected according according to proportion of the vote that they get. So it's not a winner take all. If you get 20% of the vote, 20% of your list gets elected. And this tries to ensure that small parties get some representation. But you also have 1/3 of the parliament is being elected through a winner-take-all jurisdiction where one person wins, whoever wins the plurality gets elected. In addition, they divided the country into three zones because they didn't have enough judges to supervise the election for the whole country at once. So instead of the election taking place over one day, it takes place over a month and a half, basically. And every zone has a first round and a runoff round. So very complicated system that they tried to introduce to a population that basically had been only used to rubber stamp elections, you know, kind of elections to re-elect the ruling party. As a result of that, the groups that were already very well organized and had been in effective opposition in the past, which are the Muslim Brotherhoods, won around 47% of the vote. The old regime, for some reason, their people were in total disarray after the revolution, didn't manage to win very much. And the Salafis, this is this new group emerging, who took advantage of the millions they had spent on charitable contribution in poor communities, won 25% of the vote. So you can see that the amount left for all the rest, socialists, liberals, new parties, youth movements, were very, very few seats. Several series of missteps in the ruling of the military council, the famous soccer stadium stampede. This was seemed like all it was is a fight and a brawl that led to a stampede in the soccer stadium, but very much appeared later that the old regime elements within the police had fomented the violence, and in fact had and the police didn't do anything to stop it. So that this was seen as a sabotage by the old regime elements to try and basically derail the revolution. So this is can seen as one of the kind of instances of the of that sort of sabotage. Now, until then, there had been some sort of an agreement or between the military and the Muslim Brotherhood. The military would allow the Muslim Brotherhood to win the legislative elections, would allow them eventually to form a cabinet, so long as they didn't try to take the presidency. And that agreement fell apart, and by March, the Muslim Brotherhood announces that they're going to put up a candidate for president, despite the fact that they had vowed before that not to do so. In fact, one of the people, one of their own leaders, who wanted to run for president was evicted from the organization and was kicked out because he insisted on running for president. And so this was a very, everybody saw this as a major reversal, but it was a way of kind of establishing their power vis-a-vis the military, because as they could see that the military was trying to prevent them from appointing a cabinet. Okay, so we move on to how does the military fight back? Well, that's my interpretation of the narrative, where basically you have a fight over the Constituent Assembly. This is the 100 people that the parliament, so in the first, the Constitution said Parliament elects the Constituent Assembly. Well, they happen to elect more than 50% of the members of the Constituent Assembly from among their own members of Parliament. And it was dominated by Islamists, reflecting the Islamist composition of the Parliament. The liberals who were in the Constituent Assembly walked off, and eventually it went to a court, and the court dissolved the Constituent Assembly as being on the basis that they were not supposed to select themselves to be the writers of the Constitution. They were supposed to select others from outside the parliament. But that was the excuse that was used to kind of, and that was the first blow against the Muslim Brotherhood and the Islamist coalition in their attempt to kind of establish their their dominance over the new system. Then you have, so clearly the constitution cannot be written before the presidential elections take place. And so the sequence was going out of kilter. To make things worse, the courts decide to nullify the parliament altogether. Now, clearly the courts claim that they are completely independent or autonomous, but I think there is some clear question about the degree to which the courts are independent from the military. So they nullify the parliament based on a technicality. I can get into it in the question and answer session. But so essentially, we neither have a constitution now, or a process to write the constitution, nor do we have a parliament. Just 3 days, however, before the court decision came down to nullify the parliament, they elected a new constituent assembly, so that just in case it could survive despite the parliament being abolished. And I think this is where sets the stage for the presidential election, where by that time the constitutional writing process is in disarray, the parliament has been disbanded, and the only thing left in the transition is the presidential election. So what goes on there? Well, we have the Muslim Brotherhood runs a candidate. It happens to be their second choice, because their first choice candidate, who was in fact the deputy of the supreme guide of the organization. The organization has something called the Guidance Council, and the Guidance Council is headed by a supreme guide. And the deputy of that guy, who was in fact not a member of the party that the Muslim Brotherhood formed, was going to run as but the election commission disqualified him because he had a criminal record having to do with some of his activism as a Muslim Brotherhood leader. So he was eliminated, and we got Mr. Morsi, who ran as a second choice. And in fact, he was often referred to pejoratively in the elections by his opponents as the spare tire, that he wasn't the first choice, he was the second choice, and he had to run instead. Now, so let me move on to the presidential elections. I'll just skip one slide. In the presidential election, we essentially had five candidates that were major candidates. Mr. Morsi, the candidate of the Muslim Brotherhood, Mr. Ahmed Shafi, who is the last prime minister under Mubarak, and he had been the Air Force chief and a minister of aviation, very much connected to the Mubarak regime. So somebody from the old regime. And then the third guy is a socialist, secular, liberal, who was quite popular among the youth groups that undertook the revolution. The fourth person is the guy who was kicked out of the Muslim Brotherhood for having insisted on running when they said they weren't going to run anybody. But he was a somewhat centrist, more moderate Islamist. And then the fifth person is the former foreign minister under the Mubarak regime, who, because of Mubarak feeling threatened by his popularity, pushed him aside and made him the general secretary of the Arab League. And then, so he was again representing the more secular liberal wing. Now, interestingly enough, 2 weeks before the first round, the polls essentially put Mr. Amr Musa and Mr. Abdul Futuh way ahead, with the three others having less than 10% of the vote. And when, in fact, some of the major press organizations had decided to have a debate, similar to the debate we've seen here between Obama and Romney the other day, they chose Mr. Abdul Futuh and Mr. Musa as the only two who were going to participate in the debate, because the others were polling way too low. And so these two debated, attacked each other. Everybody said after the debate they both lost. So who wins? Well, rise up the other guys. But even until a week before the election, there was very little question about these two guys going on top. So what explains the results of the first round, where Mr. Morsi and Mr. Shafi each get around a quarter of the vote, and then the three others are getting significantly less? And this is where I had to myself relearn an important lesson, which is elections in countries like Egypt that had been manipulated over the years would, even after the revolution, still operated not on the person that basically individual preference, but it operated on the basis of block votes and collective voting. So it's patronage networks, it's who has the networks on the ground who's able to mobilize a large number of people to go to the polls to vote in the way they want. And so in fact, the only two of these candidates that had a machine behind them that could do this voter mobilization at the local level were the top two. Morsi, because he had the Muslim Brotherhood, very organized movement. In fact, the Muslim Brotherhood, remember, had dominated the parliamentary elections, even though the parliament members were no longer in parliament because the parliament was abolished. They were told, if you don't mobilize each 10,000 voters, you will not be allowed to run again in parliamentary elections. They were told that by the organization of the Muslim Brotherhood. So this is a way for them to use these people who had already mobilized a lot of votes at the local level to mobilize votes for Mr. Morsi. And Mr. Shafi, of course, used the old patronage networks of the old ruling party, the National Democratic Party, to bring out the vote for Shafi. So these two, in fact, on an individual basis, among the people who would answer polls, were the least popular, but they ended up getting the most votes. Now, in addition, the liberal vote, or the kind of non-Islamist, non-old regime vote, was split among those three other candidates. Had one of them stepped out, another one of them would have very probably gotten enough votes to be able to compete in the second round. And the other contention that I would make is that if any of the ones that became third, fourth, or fifth had taken the place of Mr. Shafi in second round, they would have probably defeated Mr. Morsi in the final round. Because essentially the people who voted for Mr. Morsi were not just the Islamists, but anybody who was a revolutionary who hated the old regime could not get themselves to vote for Mr. Shafi. And so he eventually gathered more votes than the Islamist base. So the point of all of this is to say that the win by the Muslim Brotherhood was not inevitable, and in fact, any other potential combinations could have worked to make them lose. They did, however, benefit from the mobilization or their capacity to mobilize voters on the ground. All right, so I'll go back to this. So essentially, this is kind of a summary of what I was talking about. There are three blocks: the remnants of the old regime, backed up by the security apparatus that was not dismantled completely. In fact, one of the things that the military did is maintain the old security apparatus in place and only change the very top, so that these people in the security apparatus could not only do sabotage and try to counter the revolution through sabotage, but they also were able to organize politically at the local level and use their connections. Former business cronies of the Mubarak regime were very important in terms of financing the election. And then the local patronage networks I talked about. The Islamist bloc is made up of the Muslim Brotherhoods, the Salafis, and some centrist Islamist parties that would, similar to what Mr. Abul Futuh would represent. And then finally, the secular bloc is the most fragmented. And that's really where, if we have a future that is not dominated by the Islamists, it would have to come from there. And these are some of the old liberal and socialist parties, some parties that were formed after the revolution to represent either the left of center or right of center that could not organize during the Mubarak regime, and then finally the youth movements that effectively led the protests that caused the revolution. So let me just say a few words about the role of the military. As I said, they kind of stepped in initially as a neutral arbiter that would shepherd the democratic transition along. And if you actually see, they've held by their word to finish the transition by June 30th, 2012. They had the election occur in late June, and the new president took over on July 1st, 2012. But in fact, because of the way that they manage the transition, we have no parliament, we have no constitution, and the prospects of doing those is still very uncertain. In addition, a few weeks before right in the middle of the presidential election, between the first round and the second round, they decided that it was too high a probability that Mr. Morsi was going to win, and so we have to constrain him. And so they passed what is called a supplementary constitutional declaration, which is basically modifying the temporary constitution, where in that modified constitutional declaration, they took away the power of the president to make any decisions that affect the military, whether budgetary or appointing military officers, etc. And they kept those to themselves. They kept also to themselves the right to the legislative power until a new parliament is elected, and so stripped the president's any kind of ability to make laws in the absence of parliament. Now, interestingly enough, Morsi was elected under these very restrictive roles, and people said this is a soft coup. I mean, this is really he's going to be elected in name only, and all the real power still stays with the military. Essentially, a month after he's elected, there is an attack on Egyptian border guards in the Sinai. And 17 of them die, and the attack is by some jihadist groups that have murky connections to Al-Qaeda and violent Islamist groups. Now, he uses that moment, which is kind of a moment that discredits the military, to basically ally himself with younger military officers who were very frustrated at the control of the older officers who were supposed to be long retired, and stage his own kind of coup against the upper military. So he kicked out the top five commanders of the military council, with the support of these second echelon officers, reversed the constitutional declaration that basically constrained his power, and essentially took the military back to the barracks in one move. Now, this is a move that stunned a lot of us, because we just didn't think he had what it took to counter a very powerful military council, but he took advantage of these divisions within the military to very cleverly do that. So right now, if you ask me what is the future role of the military in Egyptian transition, I'll tell you, well, I don't know. Because it really depends the extent to which these younger officers are willing to kind of accept the authority of a Muslim Brotherhood president over the military. And whether they're going to insist on these articles in the constitution to protect the autonomy of the military, etc. So this is it's an open question. So let me kind of talk about the prospects for the future for a moment, because I know I'm coming close to my 45 minutes. Well, clearly there are some worrisome signs in terms of the Muslim Brotherhood itself. The Muslim Brotherhood is far from being a democratic organization. It is an opaque, relatively secret, hierarchical organization, in which the motto is listen and obey. This is the way that the members are told you're going to listen and obey, and basically the guidance is coming from the guidance council, headed by the supreme guide, down to the troops, so to speak. It is also a transnational organization in the sense that they have units of the Muslim Brotherhood in just about nearly every country of the region: Morocco, Tunisia, Libya, Jordan, Syria, Egypt, Yemen. And while they don't act as a single organism, they coordinate across these different Muslim Brotherhood. Now, it's kind of understandable, though, why they developed in this way. They had been essentially persecuted for the past 50 years as an illegal organization. And so creating a secretive hierarchical organization is a form of survival in some sense. So whether they're going to actually be able to adapt and become more democratic and more open as they operate in a democratic arena is a question. And at this point, it's not clear that they can let go of that tradition. Now, when you observe them in action during the first few months, especially at the time of the parliamentary elections and what they did in parliament, they essentially, their instinct was to take over. And there was not to share power. And so whether it's the Constituent Assembly or it's the parliament itself, even the formation of the committees in parliament, etc. So their initial instincts were very worrisome. It's about taking over. Now, the Salafis, initially I thought that the Salafis were going to play a somewhat independent role, but actually when it came to parliament, they allied themselves fairly closely with the Muslim Brotherhood, but their main objective is to apply Sharia law. This is all they want. And so if the Muslim Brotherhood are going to be the direct way to doing what, they're going to ally with them. So the Salafis are very much one-track minded in that sense. And then you also have the periodic flare-ups of sectarian violence, attacks against churches and against Copts in general, and that's something that keeps occurring on a fairly periodic basis. So these are worrisome signs. I think that they are not, they are countered by other fairly positive things that have been happening. So as I mentioned earlier, the fact that the population is so politically engaged, especially the young people, is what gives me hope that there's going to be some sort of organizing in the political sphere to counter the power of the Muslim Brotherhood. There are now clear attempts on the part of this liberal opposition to form a single political entity in a party that is headed by Mohammed al-Baradei, who used to be the IAEA, the International Atomic Agency Executive Director, and he won the Nobel Prize, so he has a lot of international credibility. And he came back to Egypt towards the end of the Mubarak regime to try to undertake democratic reforms, and he's quite popular among the youth. Now, even if that doesn't happen very fast, it seems like the Muslim Brotherhood is pursuing fairly pragmatic policies on the ground. So if you look at their economic policies, they are quite market-oriented, they are private sector-oriented, but they are not necessarily allied to the large businesses and the cronies that the Mubarak regime was based on. Their focus is much more likely to be on the small and medium enterprises, and those are the ones that are probably most likely to generate significant employment in Egypt. So that, to me, is kind of a somewhat pragmatic. I don't know about their skill at running the economy, since they don't have a lot of economic expertise among them, but hopefully they will draw upon people who have these skills. They have a commitment to root out corruption, which is quite important in the context of the high corruption levels in the previous regime. In terms of foreign policy, they've pursued a fairly independent foreign policy, but one that I think was also quite pragmatic. So for instance, Morsi decided to go to Iran to attend the Non-Aligned Conference, the Conference on Non-Aligned Nations. And of course, the US was very upset about that. But while in Iran, he gave this very important speech with Ahmadinejad sitting right next to him, supporting the Syrian opposition and condemning the Syrian government for what it's doing to its own people, when Ahmadinejad is one of the biggest supporters of the Syrian government. So he basically managed to show that he can take a fairly independent and pragmatic foreign policy. Morsi is trying to create a sort of a group of four between Turkey, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, and Iran as a way to try and contribute to the solution of the Syrian conflict. So positive signs in terms of their, at least their the insect seems to be in the right place in terms of foreign policy. Okay, so I'm gonna basically not talk too much since I think we're at the 45 minute mark. There are a lot of international regional implications. A lot of people are interested in how the new Muslim Brotherhood government in Egypt is gonna how they're gonna deal with the peace treaty with Israel. Very briefly, they said they're committed to all of Egypt's international obligations, but clearly they're not going to be enthusiastically pursuing a warm peace with Israel. They're going to be trying to open up the border with Gaza and creating a more less of a blockade of Gaza than was the case before. In terms of relationship with the U.S., we of course know the demonstrations in Cairo that and the breach of the walls of the American embassy as a result of the film that that denigrated the prophet. However, once they got the message from the U.S. that this is not tolerable, the next day, I was in Cairo, in fact, basically 2 days after the beginning of these demonstrations, there was complete calm. So Morsi got the message that he cannot basically placate the Islamist opposition and also be a respectable player on the international arena. And so they put a complete close to these demonstrations very quickly once they got the message from the U.S. Again, a sign of some of pragmatism in my view. Now, relationship with Iran, I already mentioned a little bit on the situation, and Hamas, they're clearly, Hamas is essentially a branch of the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood. They've gone more radical as they had to face a conflict situation, but essentially they were originally part of the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood. Okay, I'm gonna stop here and basically take your questions. Yes.
You see the Muslim Brotherhood going more the direction of Iran, more of like a Islamic theocracy. Do you see them more going to a more like a plurality, becoming more of a role like religious writings here in the U.S.?
Yeah, I mean, actually, the I don't see them going the direction of Iran. Do I see them going more the direction of Iran in a form of a theocracy, or more kind of working within a more pluralistic,
like
the religious right in the U.S.? I think the analogy with the religious right is not a bad one. I mean, I think in a sense that they are committed to a much bigger role for religion in politics, but I think they are going to be willing to play the democratic game. So I see them, the better analogy in my view is what the Islamist party, the parties in Turkey have been doing. So they have an Islamist orientation, but they have committed to a democratic pluralistic system, and they are basically taking a fairly moderate. So in a way, the best scenario for Egypt would be something along the lines of what Turkey happened in Turkey, or to some extent, something along the line of what happened to Indonesia after they pushed out Suharto. I consider that, so what happened in Indonesia initially, there was an Islamist president was elected. In the rough and tumble of politics, this person lost popularity, and in the next election, they were voted out, and somebody else came, without an Islamic tendency, was elected. And so, in the case of Indonesia, there was no, it's not like democracy for once and never again, right? And so they played the game and were pretty much willing to pull out. Now, you could have, however, a situation in which, in a way, I see the kind of, those are some best case scenarios. A worst case scenario, in my view, is not Iran, because Iran, the revolution destroyed all the institutions and started from scratch in brand new institutions dominated by the Islamist, by the Islamist state, so to speak. So in Egypt, we still have this, the court system, the judiciary is intact, the military is intact, and so enough institutions remain that constrain the ability of the Islamists to kind of tailor the new system to themselves completely. But I see the worst case scenario in our case is a Pakistan, right? Where it's a, Islamists have a lot of influence, it's very fragmented, very unstable, but also the military continues to play a very important role in the background. And that to me is a potential direction I hope the country doesn't go through, but potentially where the country can go. Yes?
I know prior to the revolution, depending on who I was listening to, the Egyptian military either directly or indirectly influenced around 50% of the economy. A year later, how much of that is still controlled by the military?
Okay, that figure is, yes. The question is, around before the revolution, we heard that the military was controlling about 50% of the Egyptian economy. And so a year later, what do I think this percentage is, or what the influence of the military is? I have serious doubts about that figure in the first place. These numbers, the military in Egypt has always been a very secretive organization. So it's not very transparent. And I think when situation is not transparent, people tend to exaggerate. And I think the 50% is way exaggerated. I would put the number closer to 15-20%. And basically, those are industries that are either dominated by the military directly or dominated by people connected to the military, former officers, that sort of thing. It's a significant proportion nonetheless. And I think that's why the military was very keen to have these protections, because the most important thing for them is to protect their fiefdom and not have the civilians kind of raid that kind of cash cow that they have. And that's probably why they kept insisting on having elements in the constitution for under the rubric of national security to protect the decision-making within the military from civilian encroachment. So at this point, that hasn't been determined yet, what's going to happen to that. So there is a sort of new agreement between Morsi and the new leadership in the military, the younger leadership, but where that's going to come out in terms of how much the civilian government is going to control those assets that the military has is still an open question. Yes?
First, a comment. I see some striking parallels between the Pinochet-Chilean military as they were transitioning out of power and trying to at the same time protect themselves with certain immunities, which fell apart. I see a lot of parallels, but where does the Muslim Brotherhood fall on the Sunni Shia? And then you throw in the Wahhabi and the Alawite and all the rest of that. Where do they fall in this?
Yeah.
You said Saudi Arabia, Iran, Turkey, and Egypt in the same breath. And I'm trying to reconcile it.
Yeah. No, clearly the Muslim Brotherhood is very much a Sunni organization, right? It is, they are, in fact, barely tolerate Shiite Islam. And so they will talk to Iran pragmatically, but that does not mean they see eye to eye religiously. Okay? Now, they are not Wahhabis, though. The Wahhabis in Egyptian political context are the Salafis.
That's what I was about. Yeah. To get the Saudi money.
The Salafis are very much the Wahhabis, and they get the Saudi support. And in fact, the Muslim Brotherhood and the Saudi crown have been at loggerheads for a very long time. In fact, you can trace that back to basically the fall of the Ottoman Empire, where the Muslim Brotherhood was very much in support of reestablishing the caliphate, and Saudi Arabia was not, was against reestablishing the caliphate. And that became the kind of the source of tension between the Muslim Brotherhood. So, Or what then later became the Muslim Brotherhood, because the Muslim Brotherhood was not started until 1928 as an actual organization. So there is this conflict between the Saudis and the Muslim Brotherhood. I don't understand all of its dimensions, but they don't like each other very much. Now, that doesn't mean that for pragmatic reasons they cannot work together.
Until a given point,
yes. But again, you know, these religious differences, you can, you know, the Salafis and the Muslim Brotherhood worked together fairly well when they seemed like their interests were aligned. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think one has to, you know, none of these things are cut and dry. There are all kinds of tactical alliances, etc. Yes. This is an excellent question. So this is about the divisions within the Muslim Brotherhood, and we've been hearing a lot of talk in the last year about the youth of the Brotherhood wanting something and the Brotherhood not, you know, wanting another thing. Right now, the way that the Brotherhood is governed, it's very much a top-down sort of governance structure. So the Guidance Council has very few young people represented in it, and they call the shots. So a lot of the youth of the Muslim Brotherhood who are allied with other youth organizations in organizing protests and organizing revolution were disenchanted. And so many of them were, in fact, toying with the idea of allying themselves with Abu al-Futuh, who was the castaway Muslim Brotherhood who was pushed out, who became the presidential candidate. Whether at the end they actually did that or they stayed in the fold, it's not clear. I think at the end they probably decided to vote for Morsi or to remain within the fold and accept the kind of obey and listen motto. But who knows in the future where their interest is going to be. So clearly there are this contestation within the Brotherhood. There's not an acceptance of this traditional hierarchy. However, the organization is very much based on a hierarchical decision-making model. So they're contesting that, which is, I think, a healthy sign. Okay, I'll go back and then I'll come to Manchu. Yeah.
Why does Qatar support the Muslim Brotherhood? And why, what is the relationship between Brotherhood
and Turkey? Yes. Qatar is playing a very interesting role in the region as a tiny country, but it's a financial superpower, has a lot of money. Qatar has hosted for basically many, many years now the spiritual leader of the Muslim Brotherhood, Mr. Yusuf al-Qaradawi. And he's also a very well-respected Islamic scholar, and I think quite influential over the Qatari ruling family. So Qatar also sees their support of the Brotherhood as a way of kind of magnifying their influence in the region. In fact, I know that, for example, some very respected journalists who had worked for Al Jazeera have recently criticized Al Jazeera as being the mouthpiece of the Muslim Brotherhood. So you can see the various dimensions of how the Qataris are connected to the Muslim Brotherhood. Manju.
Of the second largest foreign aid after Israel.
and most of it military.
Most of it military. So that's one I was interested in your understanding. And the second is, if you can please explain about conflict with the Copts. And what percentage are Copts? And, you know, I was quite taken aback by the conflict.
Okay.
I guess going upon that, aren't there Copts in different parts? Because some of them are have different theological stuff. Some of them are
okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's start with the question about the military. You're absolutely right. The military in Egypt has been dramatically strengthened by this flow of military aid. In fact, the military aid coming from the U.S. comes in the forms of weapon systems and equipment. It doesn't even go into the budget. So it allows them to then release a lot of their own funds to get into the economic sphere and get all kinds of businesses, etc. So that exists. The one thing that makes me somewhat optimistic that we're not going to be in a Pakistan-like scenario is that the political system in Pakistan is very much subdivided upon regional affiliation. You know, if you're in the PPP, you must be a Sindhi. If you're, you know, there isn't a similar sort of fragmentation in Egypt along regional lines. So the divisions among Egyptian society are not as represented in the political system in the way that they are in Pakistan. Makes that the very weak civil society or civic state in some sense in Pakistan. But again, you know, as I said, it's a potential route, that path that we could go to. In terms of the Copts make up around 10% of the population. 95% of Egyptian Christians are Coptic Orthodox. This is a very old church that was started in the first century. It is said by Saint Mark himself. They very quickly got into disagreements with the Byzantine church. And so there's a separation between the so-called Oriental Orthodox Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church. And then later on, you had the separation between the Byzantines and the Catholics. So the Copts have their own pope. In fact, the pope died recently, and they've been in the process of electing a new pope. And it's been taken the last 6 months, basically, where it's choosing the electors, and then the electors organize themselves. So that hasn't been resolved yet. Now, there has been a regular pattern of flare-ups between Copts and Muslims in Egypt for a long time. The end of the Mubarak regime itself, if you had basically January, New Year's Eve, of the eve of the revolution, basically, there was a bomb attack against a church in Alexandria. A year before that, on Coptic Christmas, there was a massacre of a number of Copts who were leaving church after Coptic Christmas. So these flare-ups occur on a regular basis, and it's usually triggered by some really trivial but there is, you know, it's a charged atmosphere in certain communities, especially in many rural areas or poor neighborhoods. The government has traditionally dealt with it purely through as a security issue, and forced people to come and have its kind of a peace council, and never tried the people who perpetrated these crimes. And so there has been impunity, in a sense, on people who perpetrate these attacks. And that pattern has continued after the revolution. And there's been at least, the frequency of attacks has increased somewhat after the revolution, but it's because of the, essentially, the entire security situation has been, the police state has been dismantled, and therefore their ability to stop these attacks has been eroded even more. So my sense is that this is the sort of thing that will continue blowing up every once in a while, but it doesn't ever build on itself to create something bigger, like in what happened in Lebanon, for example. Most of the vast majority of the population really worries about this getting bigger, and so it's always pushed under the rug. And that's kind of the way that it's been dealt with.
And the Copts that were not, like, otherwise connected with the
Mubarak regime? No. There's been, I mean, the Copts tend to be somewhat more educated and also more involved in business, but they were not in any case more connected to the Mubarak regime. However, when it came to voting, when they had a choice between Shafi and Morsi, they went for Shafi, of course. Yeah, I mean, there's very little distinction within Egypt, and the Coptic Catholics, the Catholics and the Protestants together are no more than 5% of Egyptian Christians. So it's a very small group compared to the Orthodox Copts. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm wondering if you could comment a little more on Mohamed Morsi's going forward relationship with the rest of the world. I think many people were surprised by his comments in Iran on Syria and the opposition, and where do you think maybe Egypt in general is going on the stance of the Syrian crisis? And I guess the technical question, how long is Morsi's term, and what is there any sort of steps for where he's after that, or where is his image going, I guess?
Okay. Let me first answer the kind of easier part, which is how long is his term, and then I'll get to the... Basically, he's elected for a four-year term. However, there's a lot of discussion right now about whether his term should extend beyond the constitution, or because his powers are going to change as a result of the new constitution. So a lot of people are saying that he needs to go up for re-election right after the adoption of the constitution. So the first term may be truncated. But once renewable four-year term is the way that at least the constitutional principles look like they're moving in that direction. Now, Morsi's foreign policy, I mean, the way I see it, Morsi is looking at Turkey and seeing how they're behaving in a foreign policy point of view, and he's trying to emulate that. He's basically trying to take a line that is independent of the U.S. and the Western line, and because Mubarak was seen as too allied with the U.S., too much of a client state to the U.S., and too agreeable to what Israel wanted in the region. And so he wants to take some independence from that. But at the same time, he wants to be on good relationship with the U.S. and the West so that he can be this honest broker sort of position. So he's really taking Erdogan in Turkey and trying to learn as much as possible and follow that model, it seems to me. You had the other question, image. What's his image in Egypt? Is that what you were asking for?
What is his image abroad?
His image abroad, okay. Yeah, I mean, I think he got a lot of respect for going all the way to the lion's den and telling Ahmadinejad in his face, I disagree with your policies about Syria. And in fact, it was a very interesting anecdote that when the Iranian translator translated, he substituted the word Syria for Bahrain. So that Ahmadinejad was quite confused listening to the, and then they told him later, no, he was talking about Syria. So,
kind of to follow up on that, President Obama went to Egypt, gave a major Cairo speech, and yet when Morsi was elected and then there was the recent violence in Egypt, you know, Obama made this kind of inartful comment that Egypt was not a friend, not an enemy, but not an ally. And later they clarified that. But why do you think that President Obama thought it was so important to go to Egypt as a place to kind of reconnect with the Muslim world? And do you think that's been successful, or do you think that maybe that is just something that's kind of beyond the capability of the United States? kind of at this period?
No, I think that definitely it was successful at the time. People were very open. First of all, nobody believed that the U.S. could elect a black president or somebody with African origin. And so a lot of our friends said, oh, no, no, there's no way. And if they elect him, they're going to assassinate him. There's no way he's going to be elected. And so the fact that somebody whom they can identify with has been elected was a very big plus. And then people actually were very open to that message of mutual respect, of I'm open to kind of this part of the world. And this was before the Arab Spring that he went. So it was. However, they expected follow-up in actions, in particular in actions on the Arab-Israeli conflict and the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. And they felt that Obama was very weak in terms of facing up to Israel in the Israeli-Palestinian conference, and every time he took an initiative, Netanyahu would shut it down, and then Obama would just go and do something else. And so that kind of eroded a lot of the credibility that Obama gained I think he also was seen as coming to the support of the Arab Spring a little late. Initially, the U.S. was very confused about what to do about Mubarak, are we going to support him or not, and all that. But I think finally, people respect the fact that his instincts prevailed and he supported the transition away from Mubarak. And in fact, what's interesting is now I hear that Romney criticizing Obama for not having been faithful to our friends in the region, i.e. Mubarak. So. Yes.
Just a follow-up. You mentioned the close relationship between the Brotherhood and Hamas. And you did mention at one point that you thought that might lead Morsi's government to be more forthright in opening up the trade again across the border. But of course, that potentially brings Egypt very directly into confrontation with Israel. So if you could just unpackage that a little bit, is there any this closer relationship between the Morsi government and the Hamas? Does that provide any angle that you see for moving the Israeli-Palestinian negotiations off of square one, assuming that in Washington at some point there always is looking for something that will do that?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I mean, I think the Morsi can leverage his relationship to Hamas to do something that is a prerequisite to any successful negotiations with Israel, which is uniting the Palestinian factions. So unless Hamas and Fatah get together and are able to deal with their differences, they're not going to be able to effectively negotiate against Israel. And that's, Israel basically has been saying, why should we negotiate with the Palestinians? Because whatever the Fatah says, Hamas will not respect anyway. And so the Egyptian intelligence has always been close to Fatah and has been trying to kind of create this rapprochement between Fatah and Hamas. But before Mubarak left, they were not trusted by Hamas. So now Morsi brings in this ability, Hamas basically being very much on the same ideological wavelength with Morsi, would be willing now to at least moderate its stance vis-a-vis Fatah and create greater unity among the Palestinians. Now, the other issue is that opening the border with Gaza also has some risks for Egypt. So, for example, Gaza is a very chaotic place. All kinds of groups that are much more radical than Hamas are running around Gaza. And it's the people who attacked the 16 border guards most likely came from Gaza and have connections to Gaza, the jihadi groups that are active in the Sinai right now. And most of this was through the tunnel systems that are under the border between Gaza and the Sinai. So the first thing that Morsi did after the attack is shut down the tunnels. And the tunnels are no longer operating. But what they're going to do instead is opening up the legal passages where they can control at least the flow of people and arms. So for him, I think the relationship with Gaza had been, even under Mubarak, the tunnels were sources of all kinds of trouble, if you want. But because they were completely uncontrolled. Whereas now, opening up the border officially and closing out the tunnels provides a greater sense of control.
Over. Just to a follow-up, but that's always, you know, Israel has always had a clear position in hand in any decision on that question. Have you picked up any Israeli response to that direction?
Well, I mean, the Israelis are basically, see Egypt's attempt at reestablishing security control over Sinai and approve of that, and do not want to get in the way of that because they see that as a problem for them too. I mean, these same groups were attacking the Egyptian troops, but also stealing their armored vehicles to go across the border and attack Israel. So, in fact, they've been very cooperative on Egyptian military's desire to have more troops and more equipment come into the Sinai for this internal security operation than what was allowed, for instance, in the treaty or in the annex to the treaty. And so right now the pragmatic part says that they're going to allow Egypt to some freedom of operation to reestablish security in the Sinai and to control the flow between Gaza and Egypt, but they're not going to be very comfortable with completely open flow of trade, for instance, between Egypt and Gaza.
As long as we got into the promise of Obama in the Arab world and the lack of follow-through, again, the comment, I'm reminded of the Jorge Ramos interview with Obama saying, with all due respect, Mr. President, a promise is a promise, and you didn't keep your promise. But what do you, if there is a President Romney, how will that play?
Well, for one thing, I've been reading about President Romney's views on the Middle East. And
not yet.
No. Sorry, Governor Romney. Sorry about that. If he said it correctly, I misspoke.
Subjunctive condition contrary to fact, if conditional, there
were subjunctive. That's right. I'm the one who misspoke. Governor Romney, basically he made a quote going this way. He's very suspicious of the Muslim Brotherhood, Al-Qaeda, jihadists, and put all of these in one group, but he thinks that moderate Islamist government are okay. Where are the moderate Islamist governments? I mean, so putting the Muslim Brotherhood and everybody else in the same package with Al-Qaeda, then that keeps a very, very narrow view of who could be a moderate Islamist government.
What is the relationship between Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda? Do they just add each other to the...
Not, I don't know of any particular relationship that exists. I mean, basically, Well, the Muslim Brotherhood has forsworn violence as a means of achieving its political ends. And they think that they want to achieve their political ends through convincing people, through basically what they call da'wah.
Yeah.
What? Zawahiri, very early on, he left in frustration and formed something called the Jihad, and then that organization. So these were splinter groups from very early on. So while they may have the same view that they want basically an Islamic State, their means of getting to it are very different, right? In one case, it's through global jihad. In another case, it's through convincing people to essentially vote for them and to gain it going that way. So.
Thoughts.